When I was 11 years old, my parents got a divorce. Shortly after, about 8 months, a year, my mom's boyfriend that she recently got moved in with us. He was an abusive person. He was an alcoholic and very evil, evil person. He once told me one time that he thought it would be awesome to be in war and to line up the enemy and mow him down with a machine gun, that would feel great. And so that's the type of person that I'm going to be talking a little bit about. So he abused my mom. They would get drunk and get in a fight or whatever. One night he abused her, and she had complications, and we took her to the doctor and eventually the hospital. They said that she had lost approximately 60% of her blood. And she died in the hospital about 2 weeks later. And so being 12 years old, 13, just turned 13, that was really a difficult time. I ended up, eventually, I moved in with my dad. He lived in DuCoyne, and his wife. And I went through first year, and I would tell people my story, friends, and different things, and they would say, they didn't mean to do this, but they said, you know, boy, if that would have been my mom, you know, I would have killed that guy. You know, and it just planted a seed in my head, and I guess, you know, I'd heard it one too many times, and I decided inside that I was going to take revenge. He spent a year in prison, mostly for breaking his probation. He had slashed a guy with a knife in a bar fight. I had witnessed it. I was in the bar with him. And he got in a fight, and he pulled his knife out, and he slashed the guy's stomach, and it was so bad that he fell up against the bar and was like this, and I'll never forget that he was holding his intestines in his arm. And so that's basically why he went to prison. He was out now. I knew where he lived. I took my stepmom's car and my dad's pistol, and I went to pay him a visit. And he was mowing his yard. I was behind a shed. I was probably 20 feet from him. And I was going to kill him. And I had come to the realization that I didn't care. I would probably go to prison or whatever, you know, as a kid, you know, you think. And I just didn't care. There was no justice in the world. I didn't feel like there was any justice. And I was going to take matters in my own hands. And whenever I was there, I was standing there, and I realize now it was God. At the time, I didn't realize this, but I realize now it was God that impressed upon me, 1 second I'm going to kill this person, and the next second it was get out of there right now. And whenever I turned around, there was a policeman walking towards me, and they found the gun and knew what I was. They knew the whole situation, and I had to get evaluated in a hospital for a couple weeks, and basically they said I was, you know, just fine. I was just kind of a product of my environment or whatever. I can't remember what they said, but anyway, I got out and I went through. Went back to school, and I started drinking pretty heavy, I just didn't care about my life, you know. And high school got over. I finished high school, and I got a job and was working. And what happened was interesting. I was drinking a lot, and I remember because I would mistreat my girlfriends. And I remember thinking, I'm becoming like the man that did this to my mom. And it was just that's hard to take, you know. So I hated myself. I didn't like myself. I didn't like who I was. And I was driving a truck over the road at the time, and my sister had called me, and she told me that Dad was dying of cancer, and he had a couple months to live. So I went home. I went to my dad's house and camped out, basically, and he ended up dying about 3 days later after I got there. And I was pretty upset about that, you know, and again, felt hopeless, disgusted, irritated, and at my life. And I was just at an end, you know. I was just done with this life that I felt just was just terrible, you know. And I remember that my sister had recently started going to church, and I had on that time off while I was away from my job, I got a DUI, and after my dad died, and I lost my job, and I didn't have a place to live because I basically lived in the truck, and I moved in with her, and she told me, she looked at me one day and says, "You need to invite Jesus in your heart, and you need to be baptized." And I was so desperate, I didn't even know what that meant. I just said, okay. And I did, you know, and I meant it in my heart. And I didn't realize until about a week and a half, 2 weeks later, that the guilt that I had been carrying around for all those years about my mom dying, I know I didn't kill her. I know I didn't do that, but I carried this guilt because I had never pulled my mom to the side and said, you know, let's leave. He's mean to you. Let's get out of there. And so I carried that guilt. But the amazing thing is that God took that guilt away. I woke up one day and the guilt was just gone. It was just gone. I wasn't expecting it to be gone. I didn't realize that was going to happen. And so it was just a miracle from God, again, that He just took that away and let me be able to live, you know, without all these burdens on me. And I joined the military at the Marine Corps at 29. And I had met my wife now before that, and we got married, Angela. She's an awesome lady. And we got married. And after I got out of the military, we had two children, Grady and Stella, at this time. We also have a young son, Cole. And but I remember we had started a business, and I was walking to the business, and it started, and it was call the man who killed your mom and forgive him. And I battled with God for about 2 weeks. There was no way I was going to call him. It was one of the hardest things I've ever done. And I eventually did call, and I talked to him, and I forgave him. And I meant it from the heart, you know, and it changed my life. He knew all along what was going to happen. I didn't have an idea. I couldn't get past the phone call of making the phone call. And what he did after I did that is he freed my life from this hatred that I had harbored inside for so long, and it allowed me to love my family better. And so God has been so awesome and patient to me, in me, with my life. It's absolutely amazing. I'm growing to be more patient. Recently, what's happened is I realized something wasn't right with my walk with Jesus, with God. And I realized something wasn't right, and I was kind of, you know, thinking about it, and I meditate a lot or just think about things, you know, and I kind of got this picture in my head of me walking and holding Jesus' hand, but Him behind me. And I thought, you know, that's all my financial decisions I've made, all these decisions I've made in the last 5 or 6 years were my decisions that I made. I would ask God, but it was really me. And so I realized that being that way, being, you know, because I got to try hard. I got to make things happen. And it's just, I see it differently now. I truly do. I think positive. I got into 4 or 5 years of just pulled into the negative things that are happening in the world, and you know how overwhelming that can be, and I recently realized that that's foolishness, that God has so much more for me and my family, and so it's been a wonderful, wonderful experience with God. He's grown me in ways that I could have never imagined, and He's given me fulfillment that I could have never achieved without Him. And so I just want to encourage everyone, no matter if you feel like you don't know God at all, or if you feel like you know God really well, to take the time out, look at yourself in the mirror, and realize that God is living inside of you, that God is part of you, and that you'll start looking at life differently. You will truly look at things in a different way. And this is wonderful. I encourage you to create a lot of people, I feel like today, you say God and they automatically think of church, you know? And that's, you know, in my opinion, don't do that. Don't put something in between you and God. It's very personal. God is very personal. He's so personal, He's inside of us. I mean, and so I just want to encourage you, and just thank you for this opportunity to share. And my name's John Furlow, and He is first.